Protect your DNA. BioPQQ can promote formation of new mitochondria. Infowarsstore.com.
You are watching the Infowars Nightly News, which airs 7 p.m. Central at InfowarsNews.com. Members can share their passcodes with up to 11 other people, and your support is helping us defend liberty worldwide.
All right, we are now live.
Do it over again.
And because early voting runs through this Friday, you don't have to wait till election day. You can vote all week.
The Rio Riva County Clerk's Office reported this afternoon that a voter trying to cast an early ballot in Española today was told he had already voted 3 days prior.
Activist on the tape goes on to suggest that discarded ballots could be collected from what she called Ghetto Aurora, saying that African Americans and Mexicans tend to throw out their ballots.
And as for those programs we do need, I'll make them work better and I'll make them cost less.
Thousands of federal workers are issued taxpayer-funded credit cards so long as they buy items that cost less than $3,000 or micro-purchases. Our review found about $20 billion in just about the course of a year.
We'll save billions by cutting waste and improving management and strengthening oversight.
We asked all of these other major federal agencies based here in D.C. for their micro-purchase shopping lists, and all refused.
I'm pledging to cut the deficit we inherited by half by the end of my first term in office.
The Independent Congressional Budget Office warning a new fiscal crisis is coming if Washington doesn't get its spending in check.
Raising the debt ceiling, which has been done over 100 times, does not increase our debt.
If you got a business, that you didn't build that. Somebody else made that happen.
Live from the Infowars.com studios.
First, Ebola is not spread through the air like the flu.
Ebola is capable of entering human airway cells. Ebola is primed to be able to have respiratory transmission.
Crashing through the lies and disinformation, it's Alex Jones. You are either with the Republic or against it.
What you're seeing here tonight is true, independent, liberty-based media, the people's media, striking back against the corporatist establishment, state-run media. I'm your host for the next 6 hours, off and on, until midnight tonight, with the rest of our great crew and all the great people and researchers behind the scenes, Leanne McAdoo, David Knight, we've got Jakari Jackson, Darren McBreen, out in the field, Joe Biggs, and so many others here tonight. We've also got a whole bunch of interviews coming up with everybody from Greg Palast to the folks at Project Veritas, James O'Keefe, and Gerald Celente, so many others coming up tonight. We've also are going to premiere our latest installment of our Second Amendment shooting show. We haven't done one of those in about 6 months. We've been so busy. We're going to have one of those for you tonight and just so much more. Before I get Leanne and David's take on what they think's front and center with this major political realignment that's happening right now, we're going to analyze the news behind the news, the rest of the story, as Paul Harvey would say. Before we do that here tonight, I wanted to go to the guys back here in the control room, and of course some of them are co-hosts of this show as well, Rob Dew, to run down the roster of what's coming up tonight.
Hey, Alex. Yeah, we're going to have all kind of things going on. We've got we're going to be having updates from Jakari, doing all the election updates. He's going to be also checking out Twitter. You can write to us at Real Alex Jones with your Twitter questions, hashtag election 2014. We're going to have a James O'Keefe interview. We showed part of that today on the show. We're going to have a long, about a 25-minute Greg Palast interview covering GMO labeling and voter fraud. And then we also shot one today earlier with Bev Harris of Black Box Voting, who's going to just we've seen a raft of all this voter fraud going on today. So she's going to explain how that happens. And then also David Knight interviewed some guys from the Free Keen Project, people who are transcending the system, kind of creating their own system out of all the chaos out there. So it's we got quite a show. Salente is going to be joining us live. He'll be our one live guest. And so I'm really excited. This is going to be 6 hours. We'll be here till midnight. And we're going to have some other special reports. We're going to play our guns report at least twice, and that one is awesome. We blow up actually one of my old TVs, and we sent it out to pasture, and that was a lot of fun.
We sent it out to pasture in a pasture. Well, great job, Rob Dew and the rest of the crew. A lot of preparation goes into this. And these big live events we do a few times a year are training for syndicating and launching the nightly news, which now about 2.5-3 years into this, we're ready to do. We've just been caught up in filmmaking and the syndicated radio show and all the other work. But we're not backed by David Rockefeller. We're not backed by the UN. We're not backed by stimulus money like MSNBC or $400 plus million a year of taxpayer money like NPR. We are backed by viewers and listeners like you. And we have cable stations and TV stations across the country that are picking this up tonight without us even reaching out to them. Great folks. We want to say thank them for all they're doing to promote freedom. And we have a huge list of stations and affiliates ready as soon as we officially launch the Infowars Nightly News, not just at PrisonPlanet.tv and YouTube, where we're also live streaming right now, but on so many other platforms, because liberty is popular. Think about the fact that when things like CNN launched back in the early 1980s, they had as many as 20 million viewers a night. Now their biggest shows have 500,000 viewers a night. MSNBC is the same. This transmission tonight, if it's like the last time we did a six-hour show, we'll probably have about 300,000 viewers. The big daily radio show has about 3 million listeners and viewers. But the reason this is important is we can just launch something out of the blue and already get to the level of CNN. And that shows how dinosaur they're really getting. We could send 3 years ago reporters like Paul Watson and Aaron Dykes to Switzerland to cover the Bilderberg Group. We had 5.5 million views just on Justin TV and Ustream in 2 days. Now we can make documentary films like Obama Deception, seen more than 40 million times on Google and YouTube. So I'm not here tonight talking about the election, bragging about the Infowars platform, but it's something you help build with your support, but it also shows the power of the people. Now, there's so much to talk about tonight. We're not going to just sit here this evening, and we are going to do it. I'm going to do it. David's going to do it. Jakari's going to do it. We're going to have Joe Biggs out there with the big governor's race in Texas. I mean, we've got people on the ground. We're going to be covering the horse races. But this is bigger than just some NFL game or some National Baseball League game or basketball. It's not just about watching the game tonight and seeing the scores. It's about seeing how big this political realignment's going to be, and can the establishment Republicans that are again in the news today, demonizing the Libertarian Tea Party, can they stop a revolution, a peaceful revolution, through the political process? And when we talk about the Free Keen Project or the Porcupine Movement in New Hampshire, there's hundreds of ways to vote, not just the ballot box, the grand jury box, the jury box, the cartridge box, but voting with your dollars, voting with your actions, voting by speaking up yourself in the court of public opinion. This tyranny can't grow and can't continue if we withdraw even a few percentage points of our support. This is a 21st century war. We're fighting these suited globalists that use fascism, socialism, marketing, you name it, to control populations. They use deception. We use truth. And so when we stand up against them, they fail. It was Thomas Jefferson said that all that evil men and tyrants need to flourish is that good men and women do nothing. The establishment has their teleprompters written by PR firms. We have research. We have passion. We have the fact that we wear on our sleeve our bias of loving liberty, of telling the truth, of supporting freedom, of supporting the underdog, of standing up against oppression. Not because we're heroes, but because we want to be treated like that as well. We understand that what happens to the little guy ends up happening to us. We understand that we're all in this great journey of being alive and conscious together, and it's an amazing time. So I'm so honored to be here with all the viewers tonight that have tuned in. I want to just say great job to the crew. So many of them here are already here at 8:30 this morning running my syndicated daytime radio show, and they're up here tonight. We're almost there of hiring a next wave of crew and reporters so that we really have some depth in our lineup, to use a football analogy. So we're going to look at what will Obama do once he's a lame duck with all the executive orders. We're going to look at the huge amounts of election fraud going on. We're going to look at solutions, a way to fight this. We're going to look at how so many candidates in the Republican Democratic Party really don't disagree with each other when it comes to NSA surveillance, police state, open borders. Though there are some candidates and some politicians on both sides of the left-right paradigm who actually do the right thing. And they're being targeted by special interest groups. People like Warren Buffett, Ted Turner, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and of course Bloomberg. So it's all going to be broken down here tonight. And listen, you can participate. You're the real power of the InfoWar. Go to InfoWars.com. Go to Real Alex Jones on Twitter. Get those live links to InfoWars.com/show or to our election coverage. Flood Twitter. Flood Facebook. The establishment made sure that they could have Facebook and, you know, Twitter, that Zuckerberg, you know, says it's for dumb effers that trust him, Facebook, so that they can push establishment garbage, so they can propagandize the population. But they can't defeat human intelligence. They want the rise of the machines because they follow orders. They want an automated society. But if we don't act like machines, it's game over for them, ladies and gentlemen. So that's what it comes down to. I know there's the talent, whether it's in business or industry or the church or in families, in little movements and big movements, in small things we do, medium-sized things, large things we do, to change the world. It really comes down to good versus evil. So David Knight, before we launch into bipartisan treason, Boehner and others working to destroy any peaceful resolution. Kennedy said those that make peaceful action, to paraphrase him, impossible, make violent revolution an absolute guaranteed certainty, to butcher his statement. We'll probably pull that quote up and put it on screen later. But here we are at this crossroads. Before we really drill into this, not with idiot teleprompter news, but real analysis, out of this cornucopia of notes and documents and articles and video pieces, what do you think is most important about this realignment that we're clearly seeing happen right now?
Alex, earlier today I talked to Mark Warden. He's a New Hampshire representative, state representative. He's part of the Free State Project. I think that's a good example when people say, you know, the elections are so rigged that it's not even worth participating in it. Do you feel that way when the Republicans won't impeach Obama when he does blatantly illegal actions, when they won't prosecute people at the NSA who are blatantly violating the law? Sometimes we have to do the right thing, even if we don't have a chance of winning. But in New Hampshire, what they're doing is they've got a mixture. Some of the people have gone there to participate in the electoral process. Some of the people have gone there to take direct action. Well, a good example of that is the fully informed jury movement that's there. They've had success in New Hampshire in passing a law that said that the judges could not censor that information from the juries or punish lawyers or defendants if they brought up the fact that they have a legal right to judge both the law as well as the facts of the case. So they got that law put into place. They also, on the activism side, are holding regular information handouts at the juries when they're selecting, at the courthouses when they're selecting the juries. So they're fighting them on both fronts. Well, what happened was in the legal front, even though they had a victory legislatively, you then had a court just recently, within the last couple of weeks, strike that down. So it's a constant struggle, and there's a balance. And I think that we ought to fight on both sides of the issue. That's why I think the Free State Project and the interview that we've got coming up later is an important one to look at, to see how different people are going to approach it. Sometimes you go around the system. Sometimes you transcend the system. Sometimes you try to do the best you can within the system. And even if you fail, it can point out the corruption and the control of the system. And that in itself is a victory.
That's right, David. So many times people are purists. They're like, you're either for gold and silver or you're for fiat. Well, no, I'm for open fiat that's crowdsourced to the people, cryptocurrencies, and I'm for gold and silver. I'm for true diversity. I'm for true choices. So it's like saying, are you a nature person or a nurture person in psychology and development? Well, clearly it's both. Or do you believe what Freud said or what Jung said? Well, both of them had some things I agree with. Both of them said things I disagree with. You've got to just use these different mindsets and views to try to really grasp what reality is. And what I know, my big takeaway that I want yours, Leanne, is that there is a huge political realignment happening. People aren't voting for Republicans because they trust them. They're repudiating the progressivism, the socialism, the cronyism, the crony capitalism, and the cult that they thought they could sell as Obama. And the Republicans are already circling the wagons to try to defend Obamacare that they're part of, to try to defend the open borders. They all work for the exact same globalists.
Yes.
We had Tucker Carlson on today. I think he made a great point. And that's that with Democrats, you've got them in lockstep with their rich donors. They're pretty much the same team. With Republicans, you've got the Republican donors that hate the Republican voters. Two different complete groups. I mean, Republican voters really do represent the last vestige, and they're certainly not perfect, of Americana, mom and apple pie. Hey, let us keep a little bit of our money. Hey, you know, men aren't bad. Women aren't bad. Hey, Marilyn Monroe's not bad. The Democrats really represent a bizarro totalitarian cult now.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Republican leadership. So this is one of these last moments in an attempt to try to make peaceful resolution possible. And the system is trying to block that. They want to have a left-right sharing of power and that we think we've got Obama down and the Republicans betray us. But that trick's over. That Carol Quigley wrote about in the 60s at Georgetown, their political scientist that the globalists, you know, follow much of his work. He said, we'll have the illusion of choice, but it really won't change. Well, they know through the libertarian movement, infiltrating the Republican Party and taking it over, which is what you're supposed to do. They act like it's dirty, that we're somehow, you know, done something wrong and that they've got to crush us and it's all embarrassing and, oh, you better run away from this Tea Party. That's why people are voting for the Republicans now, just like they voted for Ron Paul, who was proto-Tea Party.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a very historic time. They intend to just keep frustrating us, till there's a violent revolution when they come to confiscate guns and forced labor, all the things they're now promoting, nationals, conscription in high school, all the things Rahm Emanuel pushed. They know they're going to bring in stimuli that make us revolt violently, so they're gearing up with the paramilitary forces, with the police and military to crush that. The problem is we've been outreaching the military and police, myself, for 20 years. They saw what we warned come true. They're not bad people on average. So what I want people to know is we're really in this fight. Before we get into all this news and analysis, humanity really has a chance here. Bad guys only win when people do nothing. David?
And when you're talking about this, just like the police, when you're looking at the issues there, it's the federalization of the police that is leading to the militarization of the police. So there again, it's kind of a national versus local movement.
And it's not that the feds, exactly. In federalism, you need states balancing with feds and feds balancing with states.
Right.
But the federal government's been taken over by foreign banks. It isn't the federal government. So when we see the feds doing something, it's J.P. Morgan, Goldman Sachs, other Rothschild banks.
One of the things I liked about the Free State Project was it moved the focus from the very top, from Washington, to the local area, to the state and local governments. And that's where people are going to have a success at this point, I believe, is whether you choose to work within the electoral system or whether you choose to transcend it, work around it as an activist. It's still that local focus. We've always heard, you know, think globally, act locally. Well, I think we need to think liberty and act locally. You know, they think globally, you know, when they say think globally, they're talking about a globalist agenda. We need to have a libertarian agenda that we work to achieve locally.
Exactly, and that
we can have
sell.
Yeah.
Not just politically, that we sell out in the culture, people are going to buy it because it's true.
Yes. Yep.
Leanne, what of all this news, what do you think's most important? What do you think's going to happen?
Well, I agree with you on the awakening. That's what's been so exciting here. Even if, you know, it's not just that the black voters are waking up to the fact that they've been voting for all of these bad policies for decades. You know, that doesn't mean, oh, you should go out and vote Republican. It's just them just waking up to the fact that you can't just go in and check off a Democrat because that's what you've always done and what your people have always done. But it's beyond that. People are waking up to the fact that we do have a police force that is going largely militarized. Not only did we see that with the response at Ferguson, but also at the Bundy Ranch. There they were peacefully resisting there, and it took a real violent turn. I mean, it was extreme. So people are waking up to the fact that this is what's going on. But, you know, we've talked about this last night. Maybe some of these independent parties, maybe they won't have a shot at winning. But it's about getting on the ballot. It's about getting in people's faces and
about educating.
Putting these, mm-hmm. Yes, putting these issues out there, letting people know that this, you know, the war on drugs is a farce, because here we have the government shipping in the drugs, or the, you know, the pharmaceutical companies don't want you to have access to medicinal marijuana, or oil doesn't want you to be able to grow hemp, because these are things that will take down the establishment. So they don't want people to have access to that. But just the simple fact that we, the people, have been able to get medicinal marijuana on the table or GMO labeling and things like this. We have been able to stand up, and it's not too late. We still have a shot at this. You know,
you're right. In a world of universal deceit, telling the truth is a revolutionary act. And just look at the Bundy Ranch. That was not a big story till the feds came up and beat people up mm-hmm. in the middle of a county, standing on state roads in the gravel ditch holding up signs. And the feds would pull up and say, nobody who's lived in this county, you know, family for 100 and something years, you can't hold a sign up in America.
Yeah.
And everybody,
free speech area.
Right.
Free speech area.
And then it was down the road, a little pin. The whole county was a free speech null zone. People saw that as Tiananmen Square.
Right.
And we said, you want to have a new Tiananmen Square, it's going to happen. The feds, you were there, David, marching across. There's video of it. In the historic video, feds backed down from protesters. And they said, we're going to shoot you. Yeah. And you didn't stop. You peacefully, unarmed, walked across. They backed off knowing it would be a PR disaster. They'd rather blow a federal building up later and blame it on us mm-hmm. and look like heroes. And so Harry Reid came out and said, these are domestic terrorists.
Yeah. The important thing about that was that people saw this happening to their neighbors and they said, you're not going to do that here.
Right.
That's wrong. And they were absolutely morally indignant about it. And rather than having the anger turn towards somebody of a different race or a different economic group, which they so easily can do in these urban settings, I mean, we've seen it over and over again with the Rodney King situation. We've seen it in Ferguson, where you have they play the race card, and instead of getting angry at the government that perpetrated this, at the government that shot somebody or beat somebody or whatever it was, they attack white businessmen or Asian businessmen or something. You know what I'm saying? They make it into a racial thing. That didn't happen at the Bundy Ranch. At the Bundy Ranch, they understood that the problem was federal overreach. And people said, you're not
going to brutalize. And again, the feds are occupied.
People. Yeah.
The feds are occupied.
You're not going to brutalize our neighbors. We're not going to stand for that. And absolutely refuse to stand for that. We had a lot of people saying, hey, you're all about this because this is a bunch of, even at the time, this is a bunch of white farmers. You guys aren't going to do anything when it happens in an urban setting. Well, we were there when it happened in an urban setting. We were outraged that it was happening in Ferguson. We were outraged that it happened in New Mexico, where the
that shows the racial programming.
Homeless people.
Every time we go out to a shooting, whether it's black or white or whatever it is, we just look for the facts.
Yeah, yeah.
Our job's easy because we're not following some agenda other than trying to find the truth and to be reasonable about what's going on. And yeah, I remember they're like, Alex, you know, you wouldn't be upset if the cops had shot a black woman when they shot that lady at the White House.
Mm-hmm.
And then all these folks said, we love you now. She was black. You care about us.
Yeah.
And it just shows how the media has dumbed it down, where you only get upset if you're black and a black person gets shot, or only upset if you're white if a white person gets shot. No, we need to care about everybody who's losing their liberties and their freedoms. Now, drilling in here, first off, anything else you want to add, Leanne, to that?
That's good. Liberty is rising.
Liberty is rising. There's so much to go over here tonight. The Democrats are running from Obama, but he's meant, like I've always said, to be a shield that the establishment has. When it gets dented and damaged, they drop that shield, pick up a new shield. So this is very predictable, getting ready to maneuver the Republican savior, a Chris Christie, a Jeb Bush, somebody like that. And so we have the Boehner Republicans with the Democrats openly saying we've got to destroy the Tea Party. It's taken over the Republicans. This is a real crisis in the establishment because it's not a fake realignment. Within the realignment this time, people voting for Obama was a big realignment, a big repudiation of Bush, torture, NSA, all expanded under Obama. So now there's another repudiation and a bigger realignment, but this time there's real change within there. And that's what scares the system. Leanne, what do you see coming out of this?
Well, you know, just coming up, I know we're going to get to sort of the way that both of the parties are very much the same, and it's kind of meet the new boss, same as the old boss. And I'm really hoping that we can kind of affect some change in that area, because we'll get to it later with Rand Paul and, you know, some turns he's kind of taken here in the last week. But it's just kind of, I feel like that's what we have to do here, is keep these people in check and keep them true to their oath, to the Constitution, to freedom. If that's what you say you're about, then be about it. And if you're not, then we're going to call you on it. And that's what, you know, that's what our election coverage is.
Look at Ron Paul. Look at Senator Sessions. Not very eloquent speakers, but they do what they say they're going to do. Mm-hmm. Super high approval ratings in their states and nationwide. And Rand is going with the establishment a little bit because he has all these advisors, trying to look more palatable to donors to be a real contender. And I get that. There's two ways to look at this. Play the old game of moderating a bit, or be who you really are and the people will respect you. Long term, that's what's going to save this country. And speaking of that, David, Leanne, let's start getting into the latest on that front, the bipartisan Boehner Republicans. What will happen when the GOP takes over? Rand Paul reviving Reagan's law, more police state, endless war, ISIS funding.
So much.
Let's get into that.
Well, you know, Alex, the Senate Democrats are trying to distance themselves. And, of course, the House representatives as well. But especially in these tight Senate races, they're trying to put as much distance between them and Obama as possible. And so you have these tremendously expensive races. In North Carolina now, they've had the first Senate race where it's been over $100 million spent. It's now $111 million, almost $17 per voter that's been spent there. Why did they do that? Well, it was mainly to try to let Kay Hagan distance herself from Obama. And all through the campaign, she wouldn't say whether she voted for him when he was running even. But it was clear on record that pretty much everything that Obama had put out there, the entire Democrat agenda, she had supported it, had voted for it, but she kept trying to distance herself from Obama. Today, they had actually starting last night, they ran a radio ad from Obama. So right here at the 11th hour, she comes out of the closet and declares what everybody knew from the very beginning, that she is an Obama follower. And so this is an amazing thing, but it's the money. Part of this is the money. There was an article that came out today on Fox News, said, what campaign spending? Americans are spending more on Halloween than on the midterms. This is very similar to what CNN put out yesterday. CNN said, what could we have bought for the $4 billion that was spent on election coverage this year? And of course, it's CNN and Fox and networks like that that are getting that $4 billion. So they have an incentive to encourage that.
And that's why they want to keep the same two political parties. And let me just throw in here that when we talk about these political parties and what they're doing, Hillary Clinton has come out and said, I'm pro-gun. She's come out and said, I want to control the borders.
Right.
They run Obama with the Bushes, who shared power.
Mm-hmm.
They're all in the same charity. You know, Bush 41 calls Clinton his son. We knew that back at the time. He was CIA. They met. They wanted to get Bush out of there, have a Democrat front for the agenda. It's so staged.
Mm-hmm.
And it's wearing thin. Can we have somebody other than a Clinton or a Bush? I mean, should they have a rotating kingship or queenship where there's Hillary the first or Hillary the second or Bush the 10th? I mean, this is, we are not North Korea, a hereditary dictatorship.
Somebody out of the CIA mafia family, I guess, it's because it's this extended mafia family that they've got going. Yeah, it's absolutely amazing.
Right, and they actually think that curbing the campaign spending is going to stop that.
Yeah, no, it's not. I think it's interesting that Fox News would take the approach and say, well, look at how much we spend on cosmetics, or look at how much we spend
on
candy for Halloween.
That's something everybody in the country basically, you know, 90% bought.
Yeah, and you're getting something for yourself. So the question is, what are the people that are giving this money, that are giving millions of dollars to these candidates, what are they getting? And what do we do about it?
Ooh.
I don't think campaign finance reform is really going to work.
I get it. You get diabetes on Halloween for your money.
Right.
They get the country for their money.
Right. Exactly. That's right.
So they're buying it cheap.
Yeah,
they bought America for less than the cost of Halloween.
Exactly.
It's interesting. CNN looks at it and says, what could the government have bought for this money? Fox says, what could consumers have bought for the money? I think we need to look at this and say, what's the return on investment for the crony capitalists that are buying these guys?
You know, they've done some university studies on that. In some cases, a dollar brings back $1,000.
Oh, yeah.
In some cases, $1 million brings back over $1 billion. It is astronomical. Leanne, you were bringing up some points about Rand Paul. What's your view on him versus Ted Cruz? I mean, look, he's not perfect, but I've known him since 1996. He's a real deal. But at the same time, compared to all the Chris Christie, Jeb Bush, I mean, Ted Cruz and Rand Paul are angels.
Well, I agree with you on that part, and I have been, you know, just really holding out hope. I knew Rand was going to have to play the game a little bit. Like you said, he has to make himself palatable to the establishment. You got to kind of pander to them a little bit. But, you know, a year ago, he came out and said that we really need to be concerned about Obama fast-tracking the TPP, and we really need to be concerned about that. Well, now
the Trans-Pacific Partnership.
The Trans-Pacific Partnership. Well, now he's come out just in the last week or so saying that Obama really needs to prioritize passing the TPP and get it done by the end of the year. What happened in a year?
It's just like Nigel Farage who's the Ron Paul of Europe, who we used to interview all the time. We can still get him on, but you know, he's gone from "we must fight for liberty, no surveillance, no police state" to "oh my gosh, ISIS, we should give our freedoms up." That shows how powerful the libertarian Tea Party movement is globally, that the Nigel Farages and the Rand Pauls could be president, could be prime minister, and now they've been given the hey. Mm-hmm. They've been given the, David Knight, what do you think the message is that's getting them to do this? Because once
I'm very concerned about that, because we heard that same comment from Romney yesterday that, you know, we need to address the economy first. And one of the things we need to do is address trade. And I said that last night. I said, I think that's code for the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Let's understand that the Trans-Pacific Partnership is not really free trade. This is a secret agreement that is being negotiated without elected representatives being able to know what is in this agreement. This is hidden from our elected representatives of every country. And that's something I think we need to be very concerned about, that they're negotiating a trade treaty in secret. And it is far more extensive than a trade treaty. These trans-Pacific, transatlantic partnerships.
It's internet regulations, free speech. It's 30 points.
That's it.
And let's think about this, Leon. I want your take on it. We're here going, perhaps we might want to know what's in a secret treaty. They've leaked a few parts of it, and it's beyond 1984, beyond Chinese censorship. It is so hardcore. It's like Samsung came out this week and said, yeah, we listen to everything you do in your house with the smart TVs. Watch what you say in the owner's manual. I mean, that's even crazier than I thought. It's like everything's accelerating. Leanne, what's your take on that?
Well, I mean, it just seems like selling out American sovereignty to now saying, oh, we need to make the government smaller here, but then making the global government bigger. I mean, that's what the TPP is going to do.
That's what they're doing. They're transferring local power to the feds, who then transfer it to globalists, and then we don't have any say on it.
Exactly. And not only that, but our elected representatives don't even have a say on it. None of them have been able to look at the draft. So has Rand looked at it?
I can't argue with your logic. I'm just going to call you a sexist, homophobe, racist.
Okay, I got it.
Why are you against women? Now vote for Hillary. You going to vote for Hillary?
I'm going to do it for Janet.
I'm going to just say right now, I would vote for you for president right now, Leanne.
All right.
And I would vote for David as president. I don't care if it's a black guy, a white woman, a Hispanic lady. I just want freedom. Can we get I want what's in the head here.
Just stop selling us out. That's all we ask.
Oh, let's talk to it. Listen, you're a man, sexist. Shut up.
Sorry. I just want them to stop selling us out to the globalists. That's all I ask.
This hour brought to you by Oxy Powder at InfowarsLife.com. Hey, real quick, let's take a little product placement time out here. He was telling me this morning, man, I lost 12 pounds on that in a week.
Go to that shop.
I said, you got to come on air and talk about it with us.
No beer gut. And
listen, let's do some real product placement, because you try these Oxy Powder pills at InfowarsLife.com. It'll change your life, in my view. But let's just shift to that and let Rob do the news director during this. He had no cue I was doing this. Let's talk about what happens in the bathroom.
Yeah, well,
needs a new
lot
jacket
if you take Oxy Powder, but it really does. I think it goes in there. Well, best thing I could say is it takes whatever's in your intestines and turns it into a virtual liquid, and then you lose weight. I mean, I lost
all that
12 pounds in a week.
The average person has 20 pounds. John Wayne had 40 something, and he had 40 something pounds of Janet Reno in there. And that's a lot of anyways.
Yeah.
We need Oxy Powder for Congress.
To me, it was worth it. It's about a week.
We need Oxy Powder. Like Congress is a big intestinal tract.
Yeah, we need Oxy Powder for Congress.
Oxy Powder.
Yeah. I think we got it.
Yeah, bring me some Oxy Powder.
Can you imagine running that through the halls? Oxy Powder through the halls of Congress.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Flushing out.
Leanne, we need you to take it. Tell us all about it.
Flushing out the guts of the government. That's what we
need. All right, InfowarsLife.com. I'm not kidding. Now every time I see Rob do, I think Oxy Powder.
Well, and you mentioned that this morning. You said something about it. I said, oh, it helped me lose 12 pounds. You're like, what? 12 pounds? Get over here. You're coming on the show.
All right, let's get serious. What do you think of the first 30 minutes of live coverage here? No teleprompters. Can we get a camera, maybe a roving camera, to come in here and show? There are no teleprompters in here.
We can't get a roaming camera, but I'll come back.
No, turn that camera right over there.
Yeah, we'll turn
camera
that
camera three
one.
Right over here, extremist.
Travis, turn three. Pan it.
Don't disagree with me, dude, or I'll say you're racist.
Go to three.
Let's get serious here for a moment.
There we go. Now pan. Yeah, now pan it and then pull back all the way.
Are you on air right now, dude?
Yeah, I am.
Okay,
I'm giving him camera direction.
I like that.
No.
There are no teleprompters.
Teleprompter free.
And you know what? I can even turn on the lights in there, and you can see, like, there's no teleprompters, people.
Yeah, just show this. There are TV screens, so we can see what's
on the... There's some TVs. You can see the TV
that's going out. What's on the video screen behind us?
That's the background. And then we have some election stuff.
Ballotpedia to keep our...
We have news articles.
That we don't even care about. It's not even about this election. It's so much more. There's so much more that we're fighting for.
It's about what happens after.
Exactly.
And do we hold the Republicans' feet to the fire? And it's about so many different angles. Now listen, we have, like, 5 pages of stuff. We've only gotten through one page in here. Should we talk to Nico Acosta and get his view on things?
Oh, yeah. Nico, turn on your mic.
He's been here since 9 a.m. Nico.
I sure have.
And he had a migraine this morning, but he's here. Look at him. He's got George Washington behind him. Nico, how are you liking it today?
It's been a long day. It's been a good day. It's been a roller coaster like usual.
But we're barbecue filled and fueled.
And tacos. This is Texas.
Absolutely. You got to have that. All right. Anything else from the crew in there? Anybody else want to chime in from the control room?
Anybody else?
I mean,
I'll be breaking in a lot, but I'll try not to do it too much.
We'll just try to.
There's Joe Jennings. He's back there.
There's
on
Marcos
articles.
Morales.
Marcos.
Let's just try to not drink too much vodka, guys.
We haven't even started yet.
We're just drinking water right now. That's
good. So am I. Now,
and, there's Richard. There's our new guy.
Hey, let's see Richard.
Welcome.
He's got a stylish, trendy beard.
Oh, well, our other resident beardy is out on the streets with Joe
that's
Biggs.
Right. Yeah, and that's Josh another Owen. Thing. We're going to have live Skype updates from
Joe
Biggs.
Hey, what about Jakari? He's back there actually going over the numbers, which are important. It's just they
Jakari,
make that
you ready? We're going to come to you in a second.
Let's go to Jackson.
He's got Twitter feed, too.
All right, he's got the Twitter feed.
He's doing Twitter
up.
Feed. We're going to go to him in just a moment. First off, Leanne McAdoo. Did you hear that caller today saying it was sexist that some of the ads on our website and Daily Caller show, like, women in bikinis? Do you think we should all be sent to forced labor camps for that?
Well, it doesn't offend me. I mean, I think sometimes it's a little irrelevant when you're like, oh, Hillary Clinton is so old. Look at these bikini babes. But whatever.
But, I mean, we'll also show, like, a guy with a beard. This prepper knows something you don't. I mean,
exactly.
It's third-party advertising.
He's like an old bearded guy.
Fine. We should just go bankrupt. It's wrong to have you holding a gun.
Hey, I love those pictures. Where did they've fallen out of the rotation on the website.
Well, wait, but that's an attractive woman.
I know.
With a gun. I can't. That's a little. That's not pertinent.
Sounds like a little bit
of propaganda. That's not pertinent. That's not pertinent. Not pertinent. Oh, my goodness. Hey, everybody knows where everybody comes to the website. I'm so handsome. Now, let's get serious, get into the news. Other big issues here. We're going to get into this more later. But, David, what are you most worried about Obama once he has no election to reface, no midterm election? He can do whatever he wants. Get that off the screen. That is not politically
racist.
Correct. That is not politically correct.
Well, we know he's hiding the Obamacare increases. We know that
knows
until after the election. So that's a big surprise for everybody. They keep telling everyone, no, it's a fable that your insurance rates are going up. And everybody knows that they've already gone up. They don't know how much more they're going to go up until after the election. There's going to be blanket amnesty. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when we're talking about the Free State Project, when people got together and said, let's take a small state and we can have an impact there with like 20,000 people who are committed to liberty. What do you think Obama's strategy is? Well, Obama is going to remake our country into something that is along the lines of the socialist utopia that he imagines, or just completely remake it. The way to do that is to bring in a reliable voting bloc that's going to vote for socialism and a welfare state.
That is so genius.
And that's what he's doing with the open borders. He's essentially doing the same thing in reverse that the Free State
David, I haven't, but exactly, because those are U.S. citizens within the country that pay taxes, that have a right to travel and vote wherever they want. I've never heard that analogy anywhere else. You've got to do a special report on that. Did you coin that parallel? Because that's true. Free State's got 100,000 people moving to New Hampshire through the system to try to promote liberty. The globalists are bringing in 50 million illegals to vote to take our guns. Yeah. That's admitted, but it is like the reverse of a free state would be a slave state.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. The Slave State Project. That's what we should call this open borders, the Slave State Project.
Oh, gosh.
Because that's really what it's about. And I think they're losing their support amongst women. One of the things that the Washington Post is talking about was how Mary Landrieu is falling back to saying you're sexist because you don't like me. It's not her policies. It's not Obama's policies. You know, we're racist if we don't like him, even though the American public elected him twice, elected her three times.
Hey.
Now, because they're being rejected, it's because you don't like me as a person.
Oh, hey, and the people are sick of that. I would literally, to use that term, have the entire 500 people in Congress be women of every color. It's going to be purple, blue, green, white, brown. I don't care. If they were promoting low taxes and freedom and not trying to force inoculate me. Sure. I mean, I could care less what color you are. I could care less what, you know, I just want you to keep your hands out of my life.
Right.
Man, I mean, whoa. And to hear Landrieu and Rangel saying people are racist, bull crap.
Right.
Well, I mean, I am sick of the BS, man. That is a cop-out. That is a load of you-know-what.
Mark Udall is on the ropes in Colorado. It looks like he's going to lose his seat.
That's because they don't like men.
He's been talking so much about abortion and contraception that they've given him the nickname Mark Uterus. It's not Mark Udall, okay? But he's still seeing his support amongst women plummet. Why? I think it's because women understand that open borders, and they see that intimately tied with Obama, is a threat to the health of their family with this Ebola outbreak. They see it as a threat to the security of their family with the fact that criminals or terrorists or what are free to come through the borders, and we try to exercise no control whatsoever over that. I think that women are looking at that and saying, wait a minute, this isn't working. In spite of all of the kind of, you know, breaking people down.
That's right. I mean, on average, women are like men, but statistically in marketing, they want to work together. They want a good future. They want to be communal. And then they've tried this communal thing, and it's a giant screw job. So now they're not buying into it. It's not that women are stupid. It's not that men are stupid. It's that we want to work together. And but once you get the women turning against you politically, it's all over.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Well, you have a lot of these women, and obviously men as well are, you know, single dads. But
racist.
Exactly. But you have, you know, schools and things like that that are getting shut down. And families, parents, they're seeing that their kids are getting a really subpar education. And then all of a sudden, there's all these illegal children being flooded into the country. And we're having to spend all of this taxpayer money to send these kids to school, to get them housing, clothing, this and that. And everyone's like, well, where was that money when we needed it a year ago for the schools and for our kids? And so parents are starting to recognize that. And I know, you know, that is with this whole immigration thing. It's really, they've tamped it down. That's one of the things they're, you know, separating themselves from Obama.
I agree.
Separated the whole immigration issue.
And it, they try to say you're racist if you don't want unlimited people worldwide to come in. People, everybody knows, including all the Hispanic Americans I talk to, we can't go to Mexico or Brazil and get free health care and vote.
I can't vote in the Swiss elections. You know, I
that's because you're racist.
Exactly. I can't vote in the Mexican elections. Can you imagine if you went down there and tried to vote? They'd probably lock you away in a jail without a hearing or trial like they did that Marine. But, you know, for months or years at a time. And, of course, you wouldn't get any help from the U.S. State Department either. But, you know, no other country does that. And yet we have ballot initiatives in Illinois to accept people and say, we don't want any voter ID. We want to let everybody be able to vote here regardless of their national origin. What does that mean? I mean, that's not saying that, you know, we've never withheld voting rights from anybody that legally immigrated here. So what they're saying, and they made this very clear when they voted on this in the state house and the state senate in Illinois, they made it very clear this is a repudiation of having any identification to be allowed to vote.
It really is mind-blowing. We've only gotten through a third of the coverage we're going to be getting to. Is Yukari ready? I know I called on him prematurely. Is he back there in the studio? All right, let's go to Yukari Jackson. He's got a bunch of news. We've got Joe Biggs coming up. I also want to talk about holding new candidates of the new blood accountable. Black Americans in the polls, but also in media, are deserting the Democratic Party. Well, I mean, it's not even deserting Democrats. Don't worship the Republicans either. Slap them around. And if they don't do what you want, go to somebody else. Get results here.
Mm-hmm.
It's like you're at a restaurant not getting service. You call the manager over. It doesn't work. Get another one over. Doesn't work. Leave. Stop supporting it. Just don't mindlessly sit there and back something. Let's get Yukari Jackson's breakdown on some of the numbers coming in, some of the Twitter information. Yukari Jackson back there in Studio B.
How you doing, guys? Yukari Jackson, Infowars.com. Let's talk about some of the Senate race outcomes we have here. We'll look first at the state of Kentucky. We see Mitch McConnell has won, according to Politico, with 54%. Moving on now to West Virginia, we have Capito, Republican. They don't have the percentage on that one. We'll come back to that. Moving up to New Hampshire, we see Democrat Shaheen, the incumbent, is in the lead with 56%. Moving down to Virginia, we see Gillespie with 56%. The Republican going down to North Carolina, we see Tillis in the lead with 55%.
Oh, that's a surprise.
In the state of South Carolina, I'm sure this will make you very happy, David Knight, your good buddy, Lindsey Graham, the incumbent, with 53%. David, what do you think about
that? I am so happy about that, Alex.
Tell him, shut up. You don't get a recall.
Yeah, you don't. Shut up. You're an enemy combatant, so there is no recall in that. And then finally, the final one they have on Politico.
Shut up. You don't get a lawyer.
It's Purdue.
When you ask for your rights, you say, shut up. You don't get no rights. And there's missing nukes. Do what I say or they're going to blow up.
One might go off.
Yeah, that's Lindsey Graham. And Georgia has Purdue at 61%. Now, a lot of the ballot measures that are people concerned about, guns, I'll talk about that here in a second. Also, something near and dear to Rob Dew's heart, marijuana. A lot of those outcomes are not yet public, but we'll keep you up to date on that.
Rob's never smoked marijuana.
I didn't say he smoked it.
I'm just concerned.
I want him arrested if he has.
I'm just concerned about the hippies out there who do like to smoke.
We're drug testing you tomorrow.
You're concerned about Obama's right to smoke pot still as he used to do it.
I'm joking. Rob Dew is a great American.
I'm sure he is a great American. And something else. Oh, how did this get on the screen? The 50 cal Molon Labe t-shirt available at the Infowars shop. I just so happen to be wearing it right now. And you guys can pick that up at the Infowars shop. And we'll look at some other things. Let's take a look over here on the Twitter page, see if we can find something. This is a little bit off topic, but I thought this was very interesting, Alex. Lori K. asked, why are there so many bioweapons labs in the area of Africa? I know you've been talking a lot about that in the recent weeks.
That's because on record, it's all a lot of it's declassified in South Africa, but it turned out it was happening all over Africa. Gaddafi was criticizing and trying to stop it. I'm not lionizing Gaddafi, but he was trying to help Africa. He was actually taking the money from his oil and trying to help everybody. That's why they set him up and overthrew him, and now they admit Libya's a failed state. He was constantly exposing it with scientists, but the South Africans he classified in 94, and people can look this up. We played the BBC clips and even 60 Minutes, but they had airborne Ebola that was race-specific to black people, Africans. They have just all sorts of stuff in the vaccines, HIV, souped up. People always say, well, where's the proof? It's even been on 60 Minutes. I mean, it's declassified. It's just people don't go look up the documents. And that's why they have the bio labs over there, is because since colonialism, here's Africa's problem. It's got more resources than probably the entire landmass. There's more in the ocean than Africa, they found, but it's hard to get because it's underwater. Africa is just filled with everything. Australia to a certain extent as well, but Africa just is so full of riches that they keep it destabilized to keep standard of living down so the people never get uppity and demand any real value. That's why every time a Westerner goes there, whether it's Merkel of Germany or Obama of the U.S., they go, by the way, I just landed in a huge jumbo jet, red carpet, $100 million, you know, this visit, and I'm going to stay in a 20-bedroom, you know, house or whatever. You shouldn't ever want a car or air conditioning.
Right.
So they want Africa to just, hey, just like you're telling us, you're ready to live in a 200-square-foot apartment. You're not going to have a car. As if we couldn't develop clean systems. They're just saying, get ready to be poor because we're going to be rich. Mm-hmm. And that's what's going on in Africa. But they'd rather Africa just be dead. And that's the problem is if you actually, the few tests they've done, giving Africa its resources and not trying to destabilize them in Kenya and in Libya and a few other cases, Africa's done great. I'd love to be able to just fly over to Africa. It's far away as England. It's like 9 hours away. It'd be beautiful, big hotels, beautiful coast. Blows away the Caribbean on the west coast of Africa and other areas. But you can't go there. It's a hellhole because it's a deliberate destabilization program that's been going on for 500 years. Well, before that with the Arabs in North Africa. And so that's what's going on. But it's the same thing in feudalism. Rome controlled Germany and France for 500 years. And if you tried to build so much more than a mud hut, they'd slit your throat. So everything we see is a continuation of Roman systems of control. Only Rome's allowed to have technology.
Right.
Only the globalists are allowed to have technology. Jakari, any other comments on that?
Yeah, just talking about the Georgia race. You know, that's one of the critical states for Republicans to take over the Senate. Now, I do want to ask a couple more Twitter, at least one more Twitter question before you guys get back to your other news coverage. Stefan Nielsen asks, or makes the statement, there are no good politicians. All are crap. We're almost all. So with that type of sentiment that a lot of people have, why should anybody get out and vote?
Well, that's a great question. I don't think it's the end-all, be-all going to fix everything. Ballot box is important. Cartridge box, if things go to hell in a handbasket, you got to defend yourself from thugs or whatever. Jury box, grand jury box, voting with your dollars. But the attitude that we're all screwed kind of trickles down to even voters. Oh, just go with the establishment. You've got to run for office. You've got to support the people. When someone has support, like a Ron Paul, they can get elected over and over again. So it really comes down to the people. Mm-hmm. If we're a virtuous people, we'll have a virtuous system. If we are a decadent people, we'll be ruled by a bunch of wolves. Jakari, what's your take on that question?
Yeah, just like you said, there are definitely some shenanigans to go up, especially at the big national races. But, you know, as we talked about yesterday, your local races, your sheriffs, your city council members, your mayor, I think those are good races to get involved in because, you know, when it hits the fan, you know, you're going to need a good sheriff. You need a good mayor not to get teamed up with these mayors against illegal guns or whatever their name is this week. And speaking on those guns, Alex, I want to talk about some of the ballot measures as far as the gun races. Now, we don't have the official numbers as far as the yays or nays, but I'll talk now about the Alabama Right to Bear Arms Amendment. And it says, if approved by voters, the Constitution would be amended, explicitly provided that every citizen has a fundamental right to bear arms and that any restriction on this right would be subject to strict scrutiny. Additionally, it would provide that no international treaty or law shall prohibit, limit, or otherwise interfere with the citizen's fundamental right to bear arms, which basically means that the UN can't come in and start slapping around Alabama, telling them what rights they can have to keep and bear arms. Another big one that we talked about yesterday was the race in Washington, the ballot measure, talking about how we see Bill Gates and also Mayor Bloomberg getting in and trying to pretty much demand universal background checks. And particularly for that race, the Washington race, the initiative 594. We saw every town for gun sense that was Mayor Bloomberg's group that teamed up with Moms Demand Action. They donated over $2 million, and also Bill and Melinda Gates, they donated over $1 million. And it says the Washington Universal Background Checks for Gun Purchases Initiative 594 is on November 4th, and it basically says that everything except transactions, well, not a transaction, but giving a firearm to a family member or an anti-gun would be subject to a universal background check.
Now, notice this dichotomy. You've got a state-sponsored bill to defend the republic, and it's not that we're obsessed with guns, but slaves are disarmed if they get our guns. The first gun laws were in the South after the Civil War by the Klan to disarm blacks that were defending themselves from the Klan and others. And Mao Zedong said political power grows out of the barrel of a gun. We have a special report on that coming up. This is so transparent. The government's arming to the teeth. It's illegitimate while trying to disarm us. You've got these anti-human people that run these Ebola labs in Africa that say, let's kill old people, let's have death panels, let's get rid of veterans on secret death list. I mean, Bill Gates doesn't just want to get rid of the black people. He wants to get rid of everybody. He is a total slime bag. His dad was a top eugenicist on record. And they're funding all over the country. Jakari just got into one case of this. I know you've covered it in detail, David Knight. So is Leanne. Here he is spending millions in races and hundreds of thousands in races to beat the Milwaukee sheriff, which they failed.
Yes,
so the good news is they're failing, and then I want to get Leanne's take on this, but we've got our own candidate where this show originates out of live in Austin, Texas, who's an Army vet, a great guy, running against the mayor pro tem who wants to run for mayor, you know, running for his seat. Michael Cargill. Everybody needs to, I don't want to hear there's no good candidates. No, you haven't done your research. I'm not attacking that Twitter guy. That tweeter. But at the same time, I'm talking to Rick Perry now. I got to get on the tweeter. But, I mean, no, you need to run or find the good candidates and get them in there.
Exactly.
So
the guy I talked to earlier from New Hampshire, he's a decent guy. He was amazed. He said, one thing I got to say before we finish, he goes, everybody talks about how corrupt politics are. He goes, you have no idea till you get close to it just how bad it is. He's amazed at it. Mm-hmm. But he's somebody who's going to stand up for your fundamental rights. Would you rather have a situation where that sheriff that was targeted in Milwaukee, would you rather step back and out of cynicism say, it doesn't matter, I'm not going to show up at the polls, I'm not going to support him in any way whatsoever, and wind up with a sheriff who's going to do everything he can to take your guns? Or are you going to stand behind somebody who says, we can't be there to protect you under all circumstances? get a firearm, learn how to use it. We'll do what we can to catch the criminals, but we can't be there when you're attacked because we don't know when you're going to be attacked, and neither do you, so be ready and be trained.
And notice in the Milwaukee County area, it's mainly whites. I think the number's like 70%. They're electing a black guy.
Yeah.
Because they could care less what color he is.
That's right.
They care about what he stands for.
And people there were upset about the fact that Bloomberg was trying to buy that race.
Mm-hmm. But that's what they're doing all over the country. The globalists are coming in, and this is just one model of what they're doing. So we have a duty when somebody like Cargill here in Austin runs to get behind him and support him, and or to run ourselves, because he'll be there injecting real issues in those debates on TV, on radio. He may not win this time. He'll probably win the next time. This is what it's all about. And that's why they try to demonize the Tea Party, because, you know, only white people would want to own guns. Only white people would want to own private property. You know, pure bull. Cubans want out from under Fidel Castro, and they're Cuban. This is universal to want to have freedom, and that's why we've got to get behind candidates, regardless of what color they are, what religion they are, whatever, if they support basic freedom. Jakari Jackson, I know you've got even more in there. Keep breaking down any other points.
Oh, I was just going to say the flip side to that anti-gun measure in Washington State, they also have Initiative 591, which is pretty much the exact opposite. They said, you know, they're not going to have any background checks unless it's a federal standard that is established, which I don't agree with that. But, you know, just like you said, there are bad measures, there are good measures, there are good candidates, and there are bad candidates. And I also want to encourage all of our viewers who are watching us, whether it's on prisonplanet.tv, on the YouTube, on infowars.com/show, send out all these links. We'll also be on Ustream here in a few minutes with Staff Sergeant Joe Biggs. But you can go to the Facebook page, Alexander Emmerich Jones, also YouTube, The Alex Jones Show, Twitter, Real Alex Jones. Submit your questions, and hopefully we can get you on the air pretty soon.
Absolutely. And we're going to have Joe Biggs via Skype and Ustream here with us on the ground at Democratic and Republican gubernatorial candidate front lines. If Wendy Davis ends up winning, you know there's election fraud. They've been caught on video organizing illegals to vote. David?
Well, they had an article today on Infowars.com that showed that the front runner, Greg Abbott, the Republican, who was ahead of Wendy Davis by 20 percentage points, didn't show up on the ballot in a San Antonio location. I mean, that's one way to close that 20% shortfall is to make sure that your other candidate doesn't even appear on the ballot. And that's what we're talking to Bev Harris about later is a lot of the rigging of the voting machines and things that can actually be done at a local level. In Eureka, California, they actually have a good solution to some of this stuff, things that could be easily done, cheaply done at other locations that would allow you to monitor the vote. And that's what we need is transparency. And that's what we're getting less and less and less and less of in government is transparency. Obama, when he was running, said, we need to be transparent. Well, he's by far the least transparent administration we've ever had.
Mm-hmm. Leanne?
Well, and also, you know, it is so important to get out there and vote, especially in the midterms on the local level, because that is when you can get your people that you know personally, like Mike Cargill, that you know who he is, what he stands for. That's what just local grassroots people.
He's who you want. He's got a successful business. He started from nothing.
Right.
It's super successful with guns and gun training. He's an Army veteran. He's a family guy. He doesn't want to run. He's running to protect our rights. He's running because he's sick of being pushed around. That's the kind of person you got behind. It's like George Washington wants to go back to his farm. Mm-hmm. We need people that are there for duty, not for a bunch of power.
Right. And then to not be afraid to exercise the power you have. The states that have the ability to cast a recall, like they did in Colorado when Bloomberg and all these outside groups moved in and funneled all this money in to pass those strict gun laws. They were able to recall three of their representatives that got
state
elected.
Legislators.
They took three of them out.
Well, I mean clearly there's been a realignment for a while. They tried to put Obama in to pacify. Now they're going to try to take over the Tea Party and stop this. But this isn't Obama, their fake pacifier. This is a real move. A lot of bad Republicans are getting elected, but still a lot of good people are being elected. That's why the system is so freaked out. Now, we're now 1 hour into transmission. It's now 8 o'clock Eastern. It's now 7 o'clock Central in about 50 seconds. I want to go to Rob Duke because there's so much they've gotten ready tonight. We've got a bunch of interviews we did earlier today. We've got live interviews coming up. We've got a gun piece that we shot a few months ago that we finally got ready, that Josh Owens did a great job putting together, and Rob doing others did a great job shooting. Leanne goes out and becomes an absolute gun addict. Tell folks about that.
Yeah, and I'm just going to let you know we are having a little bit of a weird funkiness there. We're having the dancing ants that we're going to reset a couple cameras when we go to break here. So you can see how the weirdness happens.
I like dancing ants.
Yeah, so we've got them. We've had three cameras go down, and we fixed one. And we're working on the other two. So that's what happens in live TV. You have this stuff happen. It's one of the fun parts of live TV. And I've done live TV for many years now, and let me tell you.
I like dancing ants. Just leave it. Who cares?
There's nothing like it. Yeah.
Like Michael Savage was on one time when we were having technical difficulties. That was like once a year on radio. He goes, hey, I grew up in New York where they'd have like Mexican TV on one of the channels, like puppets hitting each other and lights falling. And, you know, it was like live. That was his favorite channel, even though he couldn't speak Spanish. And you know, that's the stuff I like. So this is real. Teleprompter free. Everybody's doing a fabulous job.
And I like that people can see behind the scenes and see where all that money is when they support us, where it's going. It's not. You're not out there on a yacht, like, taking all these vacations.
I wish I was.
You know, 10 convertibles.
Sounds pretty good.
I know, but it's this. You're putting the money back into this operation, and you can see it, even though sometimes we got a little split screen going on. But
well, no, I mean, quite frankly, since we're on the subject, if I wanted to make more money, I would have a radio show and a news blog that I push everybody to. Look at this picture on my website. Look at this article I linked to, just to send all my audience there. I'd have three people here, like Rush Limbaugh. See, Rush Limbaugh has a jet and a 20-bedroom house, which is great. It's his money. I have this. See, I've spent 70, we were doing the math, in the last 15 years alone, been on there 20 years, but the first five, it was just me. I've spent $70 million on running the operation, promoting it, doing all this. $70
million. Oh, but you could have sold your soul to the globalists.
Well, but it's a testament to free market, what's left of it.
Hey, Alex, that's still not as much as our public servants have spent on their micro purchases to the tune of $20 billion.
In the last year, the feds,
1 year,
on their micro purchases that don't count, $20 billion. They can go buy like $3,000 televisions on taxpayer money. Well, I mean, to be clear, that's easy.
They're structuring their purchases, Trav. You know, that's exactly what they're accusing these small businesses of doing, is structuring their deposits and then going in and confiscating their bank accounts. And yet these guys are structuring their purchases. That's exactly what they're doing.
Right. Or even
it's just like the IRS scandals, you know, where the IRS says, we lost all of our records. We don't have that anymore. They will rake you over the coals and not take an excuse if you have a hard disk crash. If you really did lose your data, they're not going to take that as an excuse. But they wind up doing exactly the same thing.
It's organized crime.
Yeah.
And they all kind of stick together to keep the thing rolling. Okay, I don't care about the dancing ants, Rob Dew.
We've actually defeated them.
But okay, great.
I do have an update. We've got the guys calling in from Skype, Biggs and Company, with Josh and Roderick, and they were just searched by the cops, of course, because probably they're terrorists. They got camera bags. anyway,
so
they're going to give us a quick update here.
That they're Infowars.com reporters. I love how when we're at Ferguson, there's looters throwing Molotovs. The cops don't care. Look, it's a reporter. Shoot Jakari. Shoot Biggs. Shoot Al Jazeera. And we're just like, okay, we were reporting that the cops are probably in the right here. These are looters, but you're attacking us, so now you're in the wrong. We just go with the truth. We just go with the truth. And so if you're ready with Joe Biggs and others, are you ready for us to go to them?
You know what? We're ready. It's going to have a technical. More dancing ants have appeared, but we like them.
You know, I want to do this, Rob. I want to go to the Second Amendment piece first that we're titling here, Freedom Grows Out of the Barrel of a Gun.
Yeah.
And so we're going to air this little 10-minute piece of just us having some fun out at my buddy's ranch. You know, there's the Steiner Ranch, that's the big housing development on the lake. But then there's the real Steiner Ranch, 12,000 acres in Bastrop. So this is the real family ranch out there. And we go out there shooting, and we've done this show 6-7 times. They're very popular. One of them's got like 1 million views. But this is just us out having fun. And this was a real test, though, of taking Leanne out, who's only shot with Cargill, a shotgun once over at Central Texas Gun Works, and it kind of blew you away, because that's Joe Biden's advice, to shoot a 12-gauge.
Than the assault rifle.
We'll see what happens with a 12-gauge versus a .223. I'm shooting a .308 Reaper. We didn't get the 50 cals out this day, but I had this idea to put bowling pins. Weldon had just got them at a thrift shop or something. I think we should shoot some bowling pins. I saw these in my neighborhood for sale. I said, yeah, let's put it on top the Tannerite. But we also shoot with tracers. You can't see them during the day. Some little Gatorade bottles of gasoline. inside a fake coyote. This is not a real coyote, folks. And I'm going to get PETA after us here. So are we ready with that report, guys?
We can do the report, or we have Biggs ready to go.
I'm ready to go to the Second Amendment
All right.
Report, because we said we're going to that.
Okay. Yes.
Look
too
at
bad,
Biggs.
Biggs.
Oh, well, let's go to him right now. I love live TV.
Nice reaction there, Biggs. He's like, it's raining.
No, I was looking up. It's raining right now.
Oh, that's why it looks like he's turned into a vampire.
That's why they want to go.
All right. Hey, Joe. Joe, we're going to come back to you after this piece here. I know you saw it. That was pretty funny. Because you notice I've got commando-level shooting, right? No, seriously. I'm the guy that jumped out of an armored vehicle and stabbed a Taliban in the neck. Hey, Joe Biggs, tell us where you are and what's happened.
We're at the Moody Theater right now in downtown Austin, Texas. We're going to go into the Greg Abbott election party tonight. We're expecting to see people like Governor Rick Perry, Ted Cruz, and also Jeb Bush as well. So we're going to try to go in there, mingle through the crowd, and get some real questions to these politicians who are going to be running our country here after these midterm elections.
Well, Joe, I heard you got searched earlier.
Yeah, they have a bomb squad in there right now running through the entire facility. The police are going through. They've got the drug dogs out. They are searching media very thoroughly thus far.
Well, I mean, Joe, let's be honest. It's like when you had your leg partially blown off and they searched you coming to the U.S. We've got to watch veterans particularly.
Yeah, you know, we're terrorists apparently.
What is your take on 2014? How big of a realignment is this? Do you have any faith things are going to change? I mean, what's your biggest takeaway so far watching what's happening?
Well, the scary thing is what Chuck Hagel was saying, that Americans need to prepare for endless war. And we know that with the Republicans coming in, there are a lot of war, bloodthirsty, people. And we know after these midterm elections, there's not a good chance that President Obama is going to get impeached or anything like that whatsoever. So he has this free reign to just sign all these executive orders and really change the course of our way of life here in America.
Leanne, is he not a handsome devil?
Just a handsome devil.
All right. And listen, this is teleprompter free news. And we are 1 hour, 6 minutes in. Joe, I want to come back to you in a moment. Okay. In fact, let's do it now. What time do we expect to see the lordships show up after it's pretty clear who's won, 9, 10, 11 o'clock tonight?
Well, they're supposed to start letting people in around right before 8 o'clock. And then at that time, that's the regular crowd. The media is going to be allowed to come in a minute and set up. But, yeah, usually the big wigs aren't going to show up, I would say, until about 10, once people start to get a bit toasty.
All right. Well, we have interviewed Cruz. We've interviewed most of the people that are going to be there. So their little handlers try to get in your way. I know you'll take over like you always do, like you're charging an Afghan machine gun nest. So just get in there, ask your questions. In fact, give us a little preview with real journalism. What are some of the questions you're going to be asking, say, Jeb Bush?
Well, I'd like to know if they're going to basically turn this into a, like you said, a kingship and just rotate between the Bushes and the Clintons over the next, the rest of our lives, basically. Just bring in little Jeb Bush one day and then bring in Hillary one day. You know, we'll just rotate back and forth throughout that time.
Yeah, it'll be Jeb Bush's kid, and then it'll be Chelsea, and then it'll be Chelsea's kid, like North Korea.
Yeah. I want to ask a lot of the people, too, about, NSA spying. What are they going to do about immigration? You know, why are we paying for these illegals to be bused to all these different parts across the U.S.? Why are we allowing them to fly without ID? Meanwhile, when we go through an airport, we have to be ID'd, we have to be patted down and groped by TSA agents. So I want to find out what their take is on that as well, what they plan to do about minimum wage. They really want to raise it up because that's really going to hurt our economy. So I want to find out a lot of these big issues that people aren't asking about, and the militarization of police, what they think about that as well.
I would ask Rick Perry, what his view is on impeachment as well of Obama, because here's the deal. You don't want to just score political points with Obama being so out of control, because they still get their agenda through. And then he takes the blame. Well, the globalists don't care. They still get what they want. We have to repudiate this system, not just with a race and a political referendum. We've got to repudiate it by some people getting in trouble.
Yeah.
I mean, my goodness. Leanne, your take, David Knight, and then we'll get Joe Biggs's take.
Well, that's exactly it. We see them really pushing away with the whole immigration because they know that Obama's just going to whip out his pen and his phone and just pass sweeping amnesty. Then if that, you know, if there's issues with that, they can just blame Obama. But I mean, I believe that you talked about this in
I believe you got makeup in my eyes earlier.
I apologize.
She's always telling me I got to wear makeup, and I do look a little bit better. But man, it gets in your eyes. How do women handle this?
You know what? Beauty is pain. Beauty is pain.
Well, that's not beauty right
there. Have longer eyelashes.
Buck up, soldier. But yeah, so they're going to just go ahead and blame Obama and say, oh, well, he did it. But we know that he's just a puppet. He was put in that position. They said, this is the man the country needs right now. He'll be able to convince everyone to just give up all their rights. And they'll think that it's so great because he's their savior. And that
it's being waterboarded.
Then it turns out that's not the case.
Yeah. I am the comic relief for the transmission. Everybody realizes this is teleprompter free. David Knight.
You know, Alex, it was just about a week or two ago that we had the FBI director outraged that they would give the ability to people with Google phones, with Android phones, that they would not allow the FBI to be able to get into those phones. What's this about? The FBI said that he was outraged that people would not, that they would not be able to get into people's phones. And so he said, this is kind of like having a trunk that even if we've got a search warrant, we can't get into. Well, the problem is that the FBI is not going after the criminals who are going into our trunks and taking stuff out of our phones, stealing our private messages, or getting into our private business, breaking the law. The FBI is not interested about prosecuting those people. So until the FBI wants to prosecute the obvious crimes that are being done by the people at the very top
level. Well, yeah, there's the FBI saying,
don't talk to us about getting into our phones.
Right.
And how he should be able to, that should never exist. They should, if they've got a search warrant, they should be able to get into anybody's property at any time that they want.
Right. It's outrageous without warrants.
Yeah.
In fact, the head of the FBI is saying Google's acting above the law doing that. We need to be able to act above the law, break in your phone, violate your rights. This is a governmental corporate revolution against basic freedoms.
Yeah.
Well, you have the IRS, too, seizing money and then saying, oh, yes, we do that, but we won't do it anymore. But you have the attorney general who refuses to prosecute them for the things that they're doing.
He loves
the attorney general. You got the FBI. They're not prosecuting the IRS who's breaking the law. They're not prosecuting the NSA that's breaking the law. And yet they say, how dare Google and Apple offer you a phone that we can't get into?
Well, David, how long is this going to go on? I mean, the corruption just mounts and mounts. Let's go back to.
Actually, we just let him go. We're ready to go. That gun break.
Okay, we just
told him to wait 10 minutes.
Okay, good. Are you on air, dude? When you're talking?
Yes, I was on air.
Okay, good. I don't want to sound like I'm talking to myself because we're up here working out the bugs and doing
Alex,
these live transmissions.
Hello,
hello, Dave. Open the pod bay doors, Dave.
I'm sorry. I'm afraid I can't do that.
All right. Coming up after this piece, we've got GMO labeling, and we're going to get Anthony Gucciardi and other folks in here. But first, we've got the O'Keefe interview.
Yep.
James O'Keefe that was done by Jakari Jackson and a lot more. So we're going to air this gun piece that's entertaining but also fun, makes a lot of great points. You get to see Leanne McAdoo becoming absolutely gun-crazed. It's beautiful to see the conversion. Then we will go to Jakari Jackson's piece with the Project Veritas guy that's been showing the incredible election fraud. Then we're going to bring in and give you guys a break. McBreen, Anthony Gucciardi, and others. Then we're going to talk to folks breaking down what's happening with election fraud. Then we'll go back to Biggs reporting several times tonight. It's all coming up. It's the major political realignment, a referendum against progressivism that's just tyranny renamed progressivism, like progressive brain cancer. And I'm your host, Alex Jones. This is InfoWars Nightly News, expanded coverage. We're going till midnight Central Time, then I'll be back live tomorrow, 11 a.m., 2 p.m. Central, with the syndicated radio transmission. Here is the piece that I think I've dubbed. It'll be on YouTube tomorrow, so you can spread it virally, InfoWarriors. Freedom grows out of the barrel of a gun.
If I could have gotten 51 votes in the Senate of the United States for an outright ban, Mr. and Mrs. America, turn them all in, I would have done it.
Part of every day, some kind of anti-violence, anti-gun message.
But I also believe that a lot of gun owners would agree that AK-47s belong in the hands of soldiers, not in the hands of criminals.
We need to do this every day of the week and just really brainwash people into thinking about guns in a vastly different way.
It's always been about libertarians, conservatives, constitutionalists, gun owners, returning veterans in the training manuals. You're the target of the mafia because you are a real American. You know about the Bill of Rights and Constitution. Low taxes, states' rights. You are diametrically opposed. So you either roll over to the mafia and let them rob you, or you're going to be listed as a terrorist. I got a better idea. We're going to expose you as the mafia. We're going to expose you as a bunch of crooks trying to steal our liberties.
All right, on your mark. Get set.
You can keep both eyes open, so when you bring it up, just relax, take a deep breath, and then kind of exhale as you squeeze the trigger. Are you ready?
Yeah!
Woo! Nice.
You never missed, McAdoo. McAdoo, you've shot, I guess, a shotgun one time when you were checking out Central Texas Gun Works, but this is your first time shooting a rifle, second time shooting, period. Is it that big a deal?
It was like cuddling a little baby bunny in my shoulder. It's like snuggly bunny.
Was it fun?
It was pretty fun. It's kind of exhilarating.
Because you were a little nervous coming out here, a little gun phobic.
Very nervous.
Have you been converted?
I need to test out a few more.
So you still don't know if you like guns?
I like guns. I just need to know what kind of gun is the right gun for me.
We're going to let you shoot a 223 in a minute. That is what Joe Biden says women shouldn't get. It is the perfect gun for a woman.
You know, guess what? A shotgun will keep you a lot safer. A double-barrel shotgun than the assault weapons in somebody's hands who doesn't know how to use it, even one who does know how to use it. You know, it's harder to use an assault weapon than hit something that is a shotgun, okay?
So we're going to have you shoot that. We're going to do some other stuff, and we're going to blow a television up later.
Fantastic.
All right, good.
Have you ever shot a pistol before?
Yes.
Okay, so you know, you put this dot in between these dots and put all three of them on the target. Now, if you look down this sight, you can see how you can see right down the sights. This one, the suppressor covers it up, but it still serves its purpose because you can still overlap them over the target. It just takes a little getting used to. I'm going to load it up for you, and then...
Chamber around. There you go.
There you go. There you go. Go ahead.
You shot a little to the right. Yeah!
Woo! Had a little bit of a kick. Might need to work on my upper body strength a little bit. Be able to handle that machine. But I like it with the silencer. I feel kind of like a gangster, like a mobster. You know, like I should be a...
Hitman.
Yeah.
But does it sound like it does in the movies? It doesn't make that... chirping, it's not silent.
Yeah, no, it's definitely
it
not.
Like a loud air rifle is what it sounds like.
Yeah, you definitely still hear that in a hotel or something. The movies lie to us once again.
On your mark, set, go.
Weldon and I literally tried to hit that half-pound charge for an hour.
We've been trying to shoot that half-pound charge all day, Leanne, and you come out here and shoot from the hip. Boom!
Like a Mac do.
That's America.
Mark!
Woo! sorry, Gloria Steinem. The women are getting the guns.
Okay, you ready?
Yeah. Ready?
Got it. Holy hell. That's what's happening to Dinosaur Media as we fire bullets of truth into their sack of rotting lies. Yeah. Freedom. The Republic. Human liberty.
My friends, Alex Jones here to tell you about some of the most important information concerning you and your family's health. Radiation levels have more than doubled in the last 60 years in the Northern Hemisphere from all of the nuclear testing and radiological accidents. Radioactive contamination is now in most of the food supply. There's only two ways to avoid this. Move south of the equator or properly protect your thyroid with nascent iodine. Looking to protect my family, I've done deep research. Nascent iodine is the purest, cleanest, absolute best form of iodine to protect yourself and your family. It's made right here in the USA, completely non-GMO. I searched out the best quality and now have developed a double-strength form of nascent iodine, exclusively available at InfowarsLife.com. Nascent iodine is on record as one of the only safe ways to detox from fluoride poisoning. Survival Shield Nascent Iodine. Secure your super high-quality nascent iodine today at InfowarsLife.com. That's InfowarsLife.com.
General, what do you think about the FBI saying that there was a terror alert on Monday about a potential Fort Hood situation?
The police are shoving people, shoving Alex, shoving the crowd.
Here we go, folks, I'm being assaulted.
Whether it's the radio show, the news websites, documentary films, or the nightly news, InfoWars is the tip of the spear.
Is this another false flag stage attack to take our civil liberties and put more homeland security while sticking our hands down on pants on the streets?
It's up to us to set brush fires in the minds of men and women everywhere. And that's what PrisonPlanet.tv is designed to do.
You watch, the Assad regime is going to be blamed or accused of using chemical weapons against the so-called rebels.
What we see now is a war against reality. It's a war against the truth.
It's more vital than ever that supporters of freedom become members of PrisonPlanet.tv and share their membership with up to 11 friends and family. Visit InfoWarsNews.com today. Become a member, share your membership, and help take the InfoWar to the next level.
Now you can watch The Alex Jones Show live as it happens at InfoWars.com/show.